Faith Church, thank you for joining us this evening. I am excited about this Wednesday evening service that we're about to watch. It literally is an interview with one of our faith missions missionaries. That's Brother Daniel Mann. He and Melissa and their children are in Skokie, Illinois, just north of Chicago. And we've been partnering with them for 7 years. They've been on the field for 7 years. And I want you to stay tuned and let the Lord use this service, this interview, to bless you and to help us know how more effectually to pray for Daniel and Melissa and their children, and also pray for all of our missionaries. So stay tuned. Let the Lord use this to challenge your heart. And then I'll come back at the end. This is part one, by the way. Next week will be the completion of the full interview. So this will be in two parts. But part one tonight will bless you in a special way. And then I'll come back on and have a word of prayer at the end.
Well, hello, Faith Church. Thank you for joining us tonight. This is a different setting. I don't think I've ever addressed the church in a service from my office like this, but we're delighted and privileged tonight to have our very own Daniel Mann to join us from Skokie. And we're just going to talk a little bit, and he's going to share some insights, some things that will help us to better pray for he and Melissa and the kids and their ministry, their church there in Skokie at Living Hope. Of course, many of you in our church know their story, but let me just say, Daniel, thank you so much for joining us and taking your time. And we're just going to have just an informal time of question, answer. You share your heart, you share what the Lord has given to you, and I know it'll help our people and bless them. But first and foremost, I want you to know that you're not alone. You don't serve alone or stand alone, you nor Melissa nor your team, but you have a church home who is standing behind you, standing with you here in Goldsboro, and we are not just proud of you and grateful for your hearts and your character and for Melissa and the just the heart for God and the heart for his work that you both exhibit. But so we are naturally proud of you, but we're grateful. We're thankful to have this privilege to come alongside of you both as your sending church, as your home church. And we want to truly hold the ropes, as we like to say, and more effectually, more effectively pray for you and minister alongside of you, and actually in any way we can minister to you. So thank you for taking your time tonight and helping us and our understanding of some ways we can better do that. And so let's just jump in. Give us a little background, if you don't mind, about you and Melissa, your family, and how the Lord worked to call both of you to Skokie.
Sure, absolutely. I do want to say thank you so much for this privilege, the opportunity to share with our church family back in Goldsboro. And I want to say we miss each of you, thankful for you, and thankful for this medium that we have here to be able to share some updates and reconnect with you in this way. And I do hope it'll be encouraging to you. Melissa and I are coming up on 13 years of marriage. It'll be 13 years in July. And so we got married in 2007, right after I graduated from Southeastern. And we worked for about 4 years in North Carolina. I worked for a little over 3 years at Landmark Church in Cary. And we have three kids and one on the way. Carly is 10, just about to finish fourth grade. Colby is 9, just about to finish third grade. Charlotte is 16 months and everywhere, getting into everything. She loves to come downstairs to the basement where Daddy's office is and get into all the stuff here. And then we have a baby boy coming in August. So Melissa just entered her third trimester.
Wow.
And so in 2011, we started making plans to come here to start a church in the Chicago area. We just really believed the Lord was calling us to this community and prayed about it for a long time. Thankfully, Faith Church stepped up to be our sending agency, and we've been so grateful from that from the very beginning. It's hard to believe that was close to 9 years ago.
Wow.
That those conversations were had. We moved here 7 years ago, just about 3 weeks ago. We had celebrated our 7-year anniversary here in Skokie. So I'm here for 7 years. We started Living Hope Church, initially in a hotel conference center, and then sharing a church building with a Taiwanese congregation. Before COVID-19 struck, we were having about 70 to 80 on Sunday mornings, and just seeing the Lord do some incredible things that we couldn't begin to take credit for, because there's no way we would have even known to plan any of the things that he's brought about. So
right.
It's been a privilege to serve here. Skokie is just north of the city of Chicago, about 65,000 people. And so that's where we're at, just a few miles from the city limits.
You're kind of right on the outskirts of Evanston, mm-hmm. That's where it's Northwestern University is.
Right.
Also up in that area, there's the Baha'i Temple. Is that right? That is nestled mm-hmm. right there on the lakes of, on the shores of Lake Michigan, just a huge edifice. In fact, I think it can be seen from the air, even as sometimes when you fly in, you can look down and see it along the shoreline.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting to me. I'm struck the couple of times I've been able to be in Skokie about the religious diversity, the ethnic diversity. Give us just a description of that area as it relates to maybe the religious demographic, the spiritual demographic of the area where the Lord has put y'all.
The first week we lived here, I went to Walmart to pick some stuff up, and I will never forget just being struck by looking around Walmart and hearing so many different languages that I didn't have a clue what they were saying, and realizing quickly, man, I'm out of my league here. This is unbelievable. Then we started doing some outreach and meeting people, and realizing that there's not just a handful of different ethnicities and cultures, but it's a microcosm of the world.
Yeah.
And I wish I could tell you that I knew that coming in here. We had done a lot of research about Skokie. And we knew that it was ethnically diverse, but even some of the things that you can read about online don't come close to getting to the heart of how diverse Skokie is. So every May, they had to cancel it this year because of COVID-19, but we have the Skokie Festival of Cultures, and there's about 40 different cultures represented there. It is unreal.
Wow.
If you were to walk down my neighborhood, so we have next door to me is a Filipino lady. On the other side of me is an Assyrian family. Across the street, a lady from our church from Nigeria. Just down the street, another lady in our church from Cameroon. And just a little further from her, a lady from Cuba. So all down the street, you're going to meet people, not just from different places in the United States, but you're going to meet people from every continent. It's remarkable.
That's unbelievable. And it's not, you know, what strikes me, and of course, I know this is typical of larger cities, much larger than Goldsboro that I'm used to, but it literally is where the Lord has brought the world and the nations of the world literally to your doorstep. And just, you know, when I think of reaching the world, I think of flying across the ocean. But in your context, it's just a matter of stepping out your door and going to the market or going to school or going shopping or going to, you know, the park or whatever. What have been some of the biggest challenges, and I know this could open a can of worms, but some of the biggest challenges as far as church planting has concerned, or is concerned, that you and Melissa feel like you have faced in these last 7 years particularly?
Yeah, you know, that's a really good question. If I can, I'm going to start with what's not been a challenge. I think that's a helpful way to start it. Because I've talked to a lot of church planters and had a lot of conversations with people starting churches in the U.S. and other parts of the world. And one of the things that's not been a challenge for us is the support that we've received from faith, from other partner churches, sister churches. You know, because as we've been here, I've realized just how blessed we are. Because really from day one, we've not had to worry about financial support. Mm-hmm. The Lord has blessed us and taken care of us through individual givers at faith, through churches scattered around the country. And then not only just financial support, but just the type of encouragement support that we've received, the calls that we get, the emails that we get, the letters that I just opened up a letter a week or two ago from a man in Parker's Chapel Church in Greenville who wrote me just such a nice letter. We get stuff like that all the time. And I've talked to church planters that, they've gone through a lot of different things as far as financial stresses, maybe stresses that they deal with people from other churches. And we've just been so blessed not to have to deal with that. I personally can't imagine what it would be like to try on one hand to plant a church and to go through those kinds of challenges, and then at the same time deal with a heavy financial stress or to deal with all kinds of relational issues. And we've had none of that. To God be the glory.
Wow. So praise
the Lord. That's not been a challenge. Church planting, one of the biggest challenges is you feel like you're building the plane in the air.
Yeah.
You never realize all of the things that you took for granted at established, wonderful churches. You know, I was privileged to be a part of Faith for so many years, Landmark and Cary, such a great church, and structure's already in place. People have already paved the way. The foundation has already been laid. Faithful men and women for decades have already gone through the hard things of setting the culture and establishing things, not just doctrinally, but just functionally. And realizing early on, you know, we're having to do all of that on the go. And so that's been a challenge. Everything from building a structure of volunteers and training teachers and leaders and planning how you're going to do events that, you know, you've never done before as a church. Things that you take for granted, whether it's a fellowship or a meal that is just such a well-oiled machine where you came from before, where now you're having to figure out exactly how to do that. So logistical challenges. I think the biggest challenge, though, has been with the ethnic and cultural diversity brings, and I don't want to say necessarily challenges, it does, but it brings so many different questions from people. Questions that you realize you've never had to encounter before.
Yeah.
Human beings are the same. We, in many ways, we have the same fundamental problem of sin and needing of reconciliation from God. Our experiences are very different. The way we process things are very different. People that have come from different worldviews, non-Christian worldviews with no biblical foundation whatsoever. And the questions that they ask, I found that just, because you'd go from having a conversation with a European person about Catholicism to an elderly Taiwanese lady or that's come from a completely different faith background.
Yeah.
And just trying to juggle all those has just been constantly driving me to my knees to find help for these that are asking these questions. I think that's been the biggest challenge.
Yeah. In light of the current racial tension that is, man, it's so obvious, certainly right now. And it seems like that for decades and centuries that racial tension has been certainly, if not in the forefront, it's been that there have been major undercurrents And now it's almost like that the it's not anything new. It's just all this is coming up to the surface again. Like you and I talked a while ago, we know only the Prince of Peace and his gospel will totally eradicate that racial tension. And we know one day that'll happen. I'm not trying to live in a utopia here on this earth, but I do believe that God has called the church and us as believers to be different and to live different and to establish a consistent testimony that, you know, as Christ taught in the parable of the Good Samaritan, there doesn't have to be this. And by the way, there shouldn't be, especially in the body of Christ, especially among believers, there should not be this tension. And I know it was a tension that existed in the local New Testament church, in the early church. I'm sure of it. There was racial divide. There was socioeconomic tension because you had landowners and even slave owners as Philemon, who were worshiping with and who had this responsibility to ethically treat an Onesimus. You know, there in Romans 16, as Paul is going through that list of names, I believe some 34 maybe different names that Paul addresses in Romans 16, and he's saluting them. I salute, I greet. And he mentions these people. And he mentions those in the high class. He mentions those who were political, had political affiliation. And then he mentions a guy named Quartus, who his name means number four. And scholars say that was a slave name, that he wasn't even known by his birth name or his given name. He was called old number four. And because he was nothing more than a slave. So you have in the church at Rome, you have nobility and wealth. And at the same time, they're sitting beside a no-name slave named number four. And so you have, and God is clear in the New Testament that they're all one body. So with this racial, cultural, ethnic, economic difference that seems to be so highlighted today, here in June of 2020, describe when I walked in the door at Living Hope almost 2 years ago for your 5-year anniversary service, I was amazed at not just the diversity, but the unity of spirit that I felt. And you mentioned the dear sister from Cameroon who was there in all of her garb, all of her native dress and her beautiful hat and headwear. And I mean, but then she wasn't the only one. There were others you had Asians, you had Africans and just Europeans. And I mean, just people from literally all over the world worshiping together as one body. And to me, I stood there and I thought, man, this has got to be a foretaste of what heaven is going to look like. As in Revelation, John writes about every tongue, every tribe, every ethnicity, every skin color, skin tone. And to me, that was precious. And give us just a word about what that looks like on a weekly basis. I know before, you know, not now you haven't been able to gather, but before COVID, what does that unity look like at Living Hope?
It's really remarkable. I've learned a lot about different cultures over the last 7 years. And I've learned that many cultures are just incredibly hospitable people. They just, it is just a part of the fabric of who they are. You know, I cannot do a pastoral visit without someone inviting me in to have a meal with them. It's just, you can't make quick visits. You know, if you have in mind a 5-minute visit, you know, just, it's not going to happen. That just doesn't work. And one of the things too, that I think that helps is people are just used to diversity here. It's just a part of the air that you breathe. So, you know, the kids grow up with it and the adults work in it and live in it. So it's usual and common for people to be around others that are of a different race, you know, different ethnicity or from a different culture or speak a different language. But what we've noticed at Living Hope is that with all the differences that people have, you know, whether that's from, they're from a different place and completely different continents and speak different languages, but sometimes it's that they're different life stages. We have a 70-year-old Cuban lady who comes to our, you know, Sunday Bible study before the service, and she'll be in there with a 30-year-old Chinese lady. Mm-hmm. And what we've noticed is just how the gospel just unifies people. It brings with it the power that compels us to love each other.
Yeah.
And one of the things that we've really tried to do at Living Hope is to focus on the gospel.
Yeah.
And we try to preach all of the counsel of God, of course, but clearly it's the gospel that unites, because we're not united by the language that we've spoken all of our lives. We're not united by the cultures that we have or the kind of foods that we like or things like that. Those things are not what unite us. What unites us is our common need for Jesus Christ and our common love for him. And so what we've noticed is that resonates with people no matter their culture. When they come and they see the beauty of Christ through the gospel, that just draws them in. And I really think people long for a church that when they see that and they are around other people and get to sing with others and pray with others and interact with others, that they really do long for that.
Yeah.
And not that there aren't challenges, and not that I don't even face some of those challenges, and not all of us, but I think deep down inside, because we share the same Holy Spirit within us and that longing to see as many as possible come to faith in Christ, there is this work of the Spirit within us to be with one another. And to another thing real quick, if you don't mind, is one of the things about the unity is we've tried to emphasize a culture where of approachability, and where people can feel free to ask questions, and to where they can share things. And so some of our Bible studies are more interactive and discussion based. And so I'm trying to emphasize that the reality of needing to listen to one another. And, you know, sometimes we have to do that because most people that come to Living Hope, English is their second language. So just sometimes making sure everyone's understanding what's being said and communicated. And so I think that has contributed a lot, because people just really have learned to listen to each other and not to assume, because cultures are very, very different. I can't remember. I think it was right around Christmas or right around New Year's. We had a large family in our church that are from Cameroon. They invited a lot of their extended family. So we ended up having like 25, 30 people now come to our church that day. And they're all, you know, dressed in traditional outfits, and it was a celebration time. And they had come for a specific reason, that in their culture, on like the last Sunday of the year or right around New Year's, there's a certain way that they like to come into church, and they like to make an offering and a donation to the church, and they like to, well, I had never experienced anything quite like that. And so I realized really quickly, I wasn't understanding exactly what they wanted me to do after the service with all of them around. So I pulled one of them aside and said, hey, can you just explain to me? I don't feel like I'm understanding. And so they did. They explained to me, no, this is what we generally do. Would you just gather all of us around this circle and pray for us and share just some encouraging words with our family, because they've come today to, you know, to ask the Lord's blessing upon their lives in this year. So anyway, things like that. I think when we just stop and listen to people and allow them to share some of these things, it makes them really feel welcome, loved, to open up their hearts to the truth. And so I think that's a big part of what's happened here.
On a personal note, what helps you personally to embrace God's heart for the nations of the world, those nations that, again, it seems like when you walk out your doorstep, God has brought the nations to your Jerusalem, really. You know, what helps you personally, Daniel, to maintain that right passion and evangelistic heart to see individuals come to know Jesus?
You know, I'm a little ashamed to admit this, but I guess growing up, as you hear stories in the Bible about the Lord Jesus or about the apostles, you know, always in my mind, I'm picturing a white person. I'm picturing an English-speaking American Jesus, right? An American Paul, an American Peter. preaching. And again, I'm ashamed to admit that, but you know, in your mind, especially as a kid growing up, I'm thinking that. And the reason I say that, and the reason that's important, is because I think for so long in my mind, I had pictured the Great Commission, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. You know, but you'll be my witnesses to the uttermost part of the earth. I think I'm originally thinking of that as a kid growing up, and even as a teenager, of the gospel leaving the United States and going to the nations. And by the way, that is what's happened in the last two or three centuries. And the United States has been a hub of missionary, a launching pad for sending missionaries. But it was really helpful for me to realize that the uttermost part of the earth from Jerusalem looks a lot like Skokie and Goldsboro and Tulsa, the places that I've lived all my life. And so just understanding that I am that person that is at the uttermost part of the earth, the probably about as far away as you can get from Jerusalem, so that I can receive the gospel. And so I think that has really helped me to understand that and to see that, in the sense that the gospel has first come to me,
right,
from the Lord, from Jerusalem, from where the nation of Israel, from where, you know, the gospel has its roots. And so, I mean, I think that has really helped me to see God's heart for the nations, because it began, you know, with me seeing that. So that has helped me tremendously. Another thing too is just, we've tried over the last several years to have a lot of people into our home.
Yeah.
And, you know, especially when you have non-Christian people in your home, or people that are newly coming into the church and they're from different places, and listening to their stories and learning about their questions and seeing the struggles that they have, the challenges that they face, has helped to give me more of a heart to see. And I think the more that you see people come to Christ, and the more that I baptize people from different nations and different ethnicities, the more of a hunger it gives you to see others come to know Christ. And like you said before, just this growing conviction that truly the only hope for the problems and the needs of the world is the gospel of Jesus Christ, and that there is no other ultimate answer to those things than what Christ has done and what he does for us. So that those things are what convinced me.
Church, thank you. That's all the time we have for tonight. remember to tune in next Wednesday night as we finish part two. I do want you to know, please be in prayer for Brenda Gardner and her family. Her dear mother, Miss Margaret Scott, passed away last night and went home to be with the Lord. She has been battling cancer for several weeks now, just a long battle. And I want us to pray for Brenda and Billy and their family. Lift them up to the Lord tonight in prayer and this week as they're making arrangements for that memorial service. And also, I want you to be praying for Sunday as we gather at 10:30. I want to encourage you, get here a few minutes early. Now remember, please, I'm just going to ask you this. So our regular attendees, there's no need to get here at 9:30, okay? So remember that. But get here, get in your place. We're having to space everything out. We have overflow seating. It's a first-come, first-choice arrangement. Some will have to sit or will be viewing the service in the ministry center just because of the spacing and the distancing. Don't let that be a deterrent. Don't let Satan use that in your mind to discourage you, hinder you, keep you at home. We're going to have a great service. I am excited. We've been praying. So many have been praying about this coming Sunday morning, and I'm excited. So I want you to be here. So many of you have already registered in our online survey through Breeze on who is going to be in Top Town, what our needs are, families that will be in attendance. And so if you've not done that yet, it will help us to better prepare for those who will be in attendance on Sunday. So thank you for doing that. Many of you already have. And why don't we join together tonight as we close our service and just seek the face of the Lord. Father, you are good. Thank you for Daniel and Melissa and their precious children and that sweet baby that's on the way. Lord, I pray again, your hedge of protection around them. Keep them strong spiritually. Keep their marriage strong. May they as parents shepherd the hearts of their children. Father, we realize that a pastor and a leader, a spiritual leader, is only as strong as their home is. And their impact in ministry is exponentially either reduced or enhanced because of their private life, their private world. So keep your hand of anointing on Daniel and Melissa. Bless them. We pray for their people. We pray that you would give fruit, eternal fruit that remains. Father, bless us as we're finishing up making preparations to open the building up for Sunday. You know our motive is that Jesus would be lifted high. Your people strengthened, sinners saved, and the gospel going forward, disciples being made. Lord, we're excited about Sunday. We don't want to go in the building if we're going to go in without your presence. We need you. Not just more than anything, we need you. If we don't have you, we don't have anything. Bless our people. I pray for Brenda and Billy. I pray that you would strengthen them even tonight. Encourage their hearts. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. We'll see you Sunday morning.